Where can I go but to the Lord? Where can any of us go but to the Lord?
Deep.
Living.
Deep. Deep. I'm sorry.
That's all
right. Living alone in this old sinful world, hardly a comfort can afford. Striving alone, face temptations sore. Oh, where could I go but to the Lord?
You know what?
Where could I go? Where could I go? Seeking a refuge for my soul.
I know you're doing.
Needing a friend, help me in the end. Oh, where could I go but to the Lord? Neighbors are kind, I love them everyone. We give all this we afford. But when my soul needs manna from above, oh, where could I go to the Lord? Where could I go? For my soul, being a friend, you help me in the end. Oh, where could I go but to the Lord? Life here is grand, with friends I love so dear. Comfort I get from God's own word. Yet when I face the chilling hand of death, oh, where could I go but to the Lord? Where could I go? Where could I go? A refuge for my soul. Needing a friend, help me in the end. Oh, where could I go but to the Lord? Yes, where could I go but to the Lord? Singing that time. We may have to send the bus back. I thought we'd all get in the bus and go on the road. Yeah, in the sweet by and by.
Okay.
There's a land that is fairer than day. By faith we can see it afar, for the Father waits over the way to prepare us a dwelling place there. In the sweet by and by, we shall be our beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall be our beautiful shore. We shall sing on the beauty. blessed, and our spirits shall sorrow no more. Not a sigh for the blessing of death. In the sweet by, we shall be unfilled in the soul. In the sweet by, we shall be on that beautiful shore. Our bountiful Father above, we will offer our tribute of praise for the glorious gift of our love and the blessing that hallow our days.
Everybody,
in the sweet by, we shall be on a beautiful shore. In the sweet by, we shall be on that beautiful shore.
That was a little better that time. This is a huge shift of guitar.
Hey.
This is an A. This is a Bill Beather song. By Linda Davis.
Life is easy when you're up on the mountain and you have peace of mind like you've never known. But things change and you're down in the valley. Don't lose faith, for you're never alone. God on the mountain is your God in the valley. When things go wrong, you made him right. And the God of the good times is your God in the valley. We talk of faith when we're up on the mountain, but faith comes easy when life's at its best. But it's down in the valley of trials and temptations that strength faith is really put to the test. The mountain is still God in the valley. When things go wrong, He'll make them right. And the God of the good times is still God in the bad times. The God of the day is still God in the night.
Amen.
Where are we going now?
Where are we going to wake everybody?
Okay.
Get your bag.
Uh-oh. Coming out of the church where we had played, and I took quite a tumble. And I was talking to a friend of mine who played with us, and he said, "You didn't fall down." I said, "Yes, I did." "No, no," he said, "you were struck down," he said, for playing that banjo in church. I don't think he meant it, but he quite meant it. G.
Sing along now if you know it. Sing along if you don't know it. Don't know. Just don't, if you don't know it, don't sing along every day.
I wandered so aimless, I feel you say. I really don't know what you say. like a blind man I wandered along. Worries and fears I claimed to my home. Then like the blind man of God did I decide. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. Oh, the darkness, come on my mind. I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. God sent his son, they call him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He bled and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior.
Money, but it has to be paper.
That's soft.
My coins hurt.
Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you green and coming to your rosy white. Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Will your soul be ready for a mansion bright? And be washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood? In the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Thank you.
Gee, waltz the violinist, I am not. So I'm going to work right now.
this church in Clay City as of right now? 200, right? Yep, 200 years. It's pretty amazing when you think about the place that stayed here that long. Almost been attempted to be burned down many times, and especially one time in the recent history when we found burnt logs in a tin bucket here in the center of the floor. But many prayers and consecration and all kinds of things that went in favor of preserving the building to come and be a house of worship and to gather there. I'm going to ask you to bow your heads for a word of prayer at this time, if you would join me in that. Father, we praise you again for being able to gather. Many of us have worshipped earlier today and been in another house of yours, and there are plenty in the area. But this one is special as it goes back all the way to the very beginnings of anyone coming into this region of woods, to be able to look around and find a place to worship. Where would we plant it? Where would we put this building? And I'm sure many answers to prayers as sites were selected and they found themselves here. We find ourselves here tonight in a continuing tradition to praise your holy name, to give you thanks, to recognize who you are and what you've done. As we look tonight, as we consider all the things that are going on in the world, we thank you for the blessings of being able to take a step away from that business, the meat grinder of the world, so to speak. As we gather here tonight, we pray that we would continue to be able to praise your holy name in song and prayer and praise, listen to the word as it's brought to us by Brother Jeff, and to be able to go away refreshed and refilled and be able to take what we have here and take it out into the world around us to our friends and our neighbors. Bless us tonight as we pray for the power of your Holy Spirit, as you promised, to come over us here in this place. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. If you have your song sheets with you, I'm going to ask you to pick those up. If you didn't get one, I'm sure there are plenty over on the little table right here. And Tammy's going to try to crank up the old peddler and see what happens. Come Christians, join to sing is where we're headed, okay? It says number 45, it's the second sheet on your song page. So come Christians, join to sing.
It's going to have an awful sound, but here we go.
say, what did God's people say and you say?
Amen.
And that works. We have some special things tonight. I do thank you for all the music and things that have come our way from the congregation. Just want to do a few appreciations here, and I probably will miss somebody, but do. Is there anybody who lacks one of the little candles? There's probably more available that we can have. And the very last song that we sing, we'll be lighting those. I think it'll be almost dark by that time. Dark enough so it makes a difference, and we'll tell you what we're going to do with that in time. But I thank you for the lighting system that we're going to use on the way out tonight, which we'll need for the lamps. All you people, again, who have volunteered to come down and sing or share, certainly the folks from out of town, and there'll be some ice cream and some treats later, just so you know, and don't run off without some of it. We've got some very special talent here tonight. Some young lady who's dressed up like she came from this place 200 years ago. So I'm very happy and very pleased to see all that you're going on here. But Lizzie, you're up. She wanted to be first, and I said, I don't blame you. So Lizzie's going to play her flute for us tonight. We appreciate that.
Sorry. Start it over.
Right back in the day, and she's done some research, and she's going to share that with you. what worship was like, what it was like being a mom and caring for the family, and wondering just how it would be leaving home, leaving town down east, coming up into the woods and the wilderness with all the animals, and certainly the trials and the challenges. So I'm going to turn it over to you, Abby, and come with us and let you take off and go share it with them.
Women in the 1820s had lots of worries when moving to an uninhabited wilderness. If their property wasn't cleared yet, they had to make do while their husbands logged trees and built their houses, all while keeping a steady faith. Most women had little choice when moving to an area. They moved to a place that had great danger of bandits and wild animals. Doctors, if there were any, were very scarce, so most women were doctors for their own family. They took care of sick children, injured husbands, and possibly even neighbors. Women also managed the entire household. They usually made all the family needed to survive. With no grocery stores, they had to make meals with whatever food they brought with them, scavenged, grew, or hunted. They grew gardens, providing all the produce that she would preserve and feed her family for the whole year. Most families had some livestock, even just a few chickens and a milk cow. Early arrivers turned to farming. The wives helped their husbands a lot during planting and harvesting season. The farmer would plow his fields while his wife and children followed planting the seeds. They also helped during harvesting season as they would help get the crop off the field. If there was a sick or injured animal, the patient would sometimes live in the house while being cared for by the wife. She would also collect eggs and milk the cow. Mothers would teach their family to read using the only book they had, the family Bible. Family members, including the children, took turns saying grace every night before meals. Mothers would also make sure their children said their prayers every night before bed. Before churches were established, parents would choose Bible readings and read aloud on Sundays to their children. The children would also learn Bible verses every week. As towns and communities grew, the need for churches increased as well. Before a church was built, families would get together in alternating homes for a Sunday service and a meal. Women played a big part in developing churches. They believed it made the area more civilized. On Sundays, the family would tend their animals, but do no other work as they greatly respected the Sabbath. They would walk or take their horses to church, sitting through a service that was at least an hour long. They would go home and have dinner, then spend the afternoon knitting or reading. The day would end with a meal prepared by the women the day before. Women settlers had their trials and troubles when moving to the wilderness, but they kept their faith and trust in God and helped grow communities across the country.
Amen. Ladies, for being up there and for the research that was done. It's very interesting to note how large a role the ladies played, the moms and grandmas and the aunts and great grandmas and everybody else that were there. It was key, because many times the fellows went back, went out on a hunt or whatever, and it's easy to miss that. And so I appreciate all that you did there, Abby, and we need to consider our young people at all our events that we have. So we praise God for you again. Jody, now before you sing, he sits up there like a bird on a roost, okay? This pulpit right here, the octagon pulpit here that we have, goes back to the old English. Preacher stands here, he looks down on this part of the congregation, right? But it's designed in such a way so that the congregation that's up here looks down on the preacher and it keeps him humble. And that was the word that I read for of a truth. So, Jody, would you share with us the word and song here tonight?
Absolutely. And it is wonderful to be up here above all of you and looking down at our band, even though they were picked on. I had a talent to be able to do that and probably play as long as you had. never lose that talent. And I think all three of them guys will share that too. Same way with singing, God gave us a beautiful voice, all of us. We had a gentleman that always said that he could not carry a tune in a bushel basket. Well, I've never had a bushel basket to carry a song in, but mine's been in my lungs. So I have a wonderful song for you tonight. This was a favorite song of a good Christian Methodist lady that was friends with my family, and I think you'll enjoy the message that's in it. Lord, you have come to the lake shore, looking neither for wealthy nor wise ones. You only ask me to follow humbly. Oh Lord, with your eyes you have searched me, and while smiling have spoken my name. Now my boat's left on the shoreline behind me. By your side I will seek other seas. You know so well my possessions. My boat carries no gold or no weapons. You only find there my nets and labor. Oh Lord, with your eyes you have searched me, and while smiling have spoken my name. Now my boat's left on the shoreline behind me. By your side I will seek other seas. You who have fished other oceans, ever longed for by souls who are waiting, my loving friend, as thus you call me. Oh Lord, with your eyes you have searched me, and while smiling have spoken my name. Now my boat's left on the shoreline behind me. By your side I will seek other seas. Oh Lord, with your eyes you have searched me, and while smiling have spoken my name. Now my boat's left on the shoreline behind me. By your side I will seek other seas.
Thank you, Jody. We have one more individual who's going to share the gospel and song before we have our message, but I want you to take a peek because the song coming up is about this old house. And look at the wood that's around you. And you can, most of you can see this. You can see this back in here. This building is built of the native red pine, which the settlers would find so heavily forested along the creeks and streams as they moved into the area. Now, this wood has a resin in it. And if you've ever been along a fence line in Bradford County and you find the old stump fence, those were the stumps that were left over when they cut these trees, and they would work around them, cut the roots off and tip them out and line them up so they kind of linked up with each other and cows and whatever. And we still have some that are quite effective even yet today. And if you break a piece off, you'll see the same red wood that's in here, and you take a sniff of it and it has a very distinct a pine type smell. You don't see much of it today, and today's pine that we have in our woods is second growth, third growth, whatever, and it's usually the white pine. But this red pine is very unique stuff. And there's been many attempts through time to say, well, the building was haunted, and we have satanic symbols carved up there where Jody sits, and we sanded those out, and we prayed, And we consecrated the building, we brought it back, and the Lord blessed. And you know, when God's people sing and praise his holy name, the evil one is obligated to flee.
Amen.
And so we're here in this place to celebrate. And this old house has survived 200 years. We pray that it will survive many, many, many more. And Wade, would you come up and share the message and song about this old house? One of my favorites. Thank you.
This old house once knew my children, this old house once knew my life. This old house was home and comfort when we fought the storms of life. This old house once rang with laughter, this old house heard many shout. Now it trembles in the darkness when the lightning walks about. Ain't it gonna need this house no longer, ain't it gonna need this house no more. Ain't got time to fix the shingles, ain't got time to fix the floor. I ain't got time to hold no hinges, nor to mend no window pane. I ain't gonna need this house no longer, I'm getting ready to meet the saints. This old house is getting shaky, this old house is getting old. This old house lets in the rain, this old house lets in the cold. On my knees I'm getting chilly, but I fear no fear nor pain. Cause I see an angel peeking through a broken window pane. I ain't gonna need this house no longer, ain't gonna need this house no more. I ain't got time to fix the shingles, ain't got time to fix the floor. I ain't got time to oil no hinges, nor to mend no window pane. I ain't gonna need this house no longer, I'm getting ready to meet the saints. My old hound dog lies asleepin'. He don't know I'm gonna leave, else he'd wake up by the fireplace and he'd sit there howling grief. But my hunting days are over, ain't gonna hunt the coon no more. Gabriel done brought in my chariot when the wind blew down the door. Ain't gonna need this house no longer, ain't gonna need this house no more. I ain't got time to fix the shingles, ain't got time to fix the floor. I ain't got time to oil no hinges, nor to mend no window pane. I ain't gonna need this house no longer, I'm getting ready to meet the same.
And that'll be the question we're gonna be asking for you to come out here in the next minutes as Jeff brings God's word. I'm gonna ask you to think about it. It's just between you and God when the time comes. When you stand before him, we're gonna talk about that a little bit later. But praise God for all of you. And I have right beside me Jeff now. Power went out at the barn tonight about 4:30. So Zach's up back home watching the generator, making sure the milk is cool and all. And so I had a Mexican shower before I came down here. And I think if Jeff acts a little overcome, it's probably because of me. But he's doing pretty well back here. I've been sprinkling in some water. So here he is, Brother Jeff.
Probably not the last. Well, we've had a lot of music. This is a tough act to follow, all this musical talent, I'll tell you. I certainly didn't inherit any of that, but I'm so glad that for all of you who did participate in music, it's a wonderful, wonderful ministry, and it adds so much to a service like this. It is certainly a privilege for me to be able to be here and speak tonight in what is the 200th anniversary of this church. It is just amazing to me. Think of all the things that this church has seen in 200 years. And as we sang Amazing Grace, I thought up here, how many times has those verses refrained from the walls in this church? The fact that it's still standing is a testament, I guess, to whatever God establishes isn't going to be destroyed. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
Would you bow your heads now and join me in a prayer? Lord, we thank you for all of the blessings that you so graciously provide to us each day, especially for the gift of your word, the Holy Bible. We ask that your Holy Spirit be present here with us now as we turn to your word, open our minds and hearts to hear what you would speak to each of us. Let your word come alive tonight. May we each respond in such a way as to bring you honor and glory. I ask in Jesus' name, Amen.
Amen.
The scripture reading I'd like to share with you tonight is from Luke's Gospel, the 16th chapter. I'm going to be reading verses 19 to 31. Now, Jesus is talking here. Jesus has been talking. He's been sharing some parables to not only his disciples, or the audience was his disciples, and also the religious leaders of the day, the Pharisees. And after he's provided some parables, he gives this story here. Verse 19. There was a certain rich man who was clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day. But there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, full of sores, who was laid at his gate, desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. So it was that the beggar died and was carried by the angels to Abraham's bosom. He's gone to heaven, right? The rich man also died and was buried, and being in torments in Hades, in hell, he lifted up his eyes and saw Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. Then he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. But Abraham said, Son, remember that in your lifetime you received your good things, and likewise Lazarus evil things. But now he is comforted, and you are tormented. And besides all this, between us and you there is a great gulf fixed, so that those who want to pass from here to you cannot, nor can those from there pass to us. Then he said, I beg you, therefore, Father, that you would send him to my father's house, for I have five brothers, that he may testify to them, lest they also come to this place of torment. Abraham said to him, they have Moses and the prophets, let them hear them. And he said, no, Father Abraham, but if one goes to them from the dead, they will repent. But he said to him, if they do not hear Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one rise from the dead.
Yes.
When I look around at all the things that have happened lately and continue to happen in our country, I see a lot of division. Constantly separation, division, strife. We're divided in our politics, race. We're divided by gender now. And of course, our vaccination status, vaccinated versus unvaccinated. Perhaps not since the American Civil War has America been more at odds with herself. And yet, amongst all of this division and separation, which is displayed regularly in our media, there is one thing that unites us all. It is something that everyone, not only in America, but around the world, has in common. It is something we don't like to think much about, much less talk about it, but it needs to be thought about, it needs to be talked about, and most importantly, it needs to be preached about. Of course, if you haven't figured it out, I'm talking about the death. You see, each and every one of us is going to die and leave this earth. Another 100 years from now, this building may still be here, but none of us will be around to sit in it. 60 million people die each year around the world. That's 164,385 approximately each day. That works out to 6,850 each hour. 114 people each minute. From the moment we take our first breath, we are all dying. We all have an expiration date. It's only a question of when. Of course, our physical death is not the end. There is something else that we all have in common. Each of us has a soul, an inner being, which is eternal. After our death here on earth, the soul lives on. Hebrews 9:27 tells us it is appointed for man to die once, but after, the judgment. We will all face judgment, must give an account for our lives here on earth. Sadly, most humans ignore the harsh reality of death. We go through our lives as if we have all the time in the world. I read that on average, a person makes 35,000 1,000 decisions each day. Now, most of those decisions are mundane and ordinary. Should I wear a white shirt or a blue shirt? What dressing do I put on my salad? Or more importantly, tonight, what flavor of ice cream should I partake? Yet, however, there are some decisions which have more lasting results. For example, the choice to sample some drugs at the urging of a friend that over time turns into an addiction. The sad truth is that most people give more attention to those mundane life decisions than to those decisions that have more serious and lasting consequences. And there are some decisions that have eternal, forever consequences. Tonight, you must make such a decision. Tonight I ask, what will you do with God? Will you make him your Lord and Savior, or will you reject him? There is no in-between. There is no neutrality with God. Billy Graham would tell the story about the man in the Civil War. They asked which side he was on. He said, I'm neutral. He put on a blue shirt, gray pants, walked outside, and got shot at from both sides. Now, in our scripture passage tonight, Jesus provides a very vivid description of hell. The rich man was in agony, tormented by fire. He begs God for mercy to let Lazarus come and dip his finger into the water just to cool the rich man's tongue. But it's not possible. There's a great chasm between heaven and hell. There's no going back and forth, no going between. The choices made during life sealed the rich man's fate. The choices he made in his life had eternal consequences. It was too late for salvation after his death. Each of us runs the same risk as the rich man if we reject God's offer of mercy and grace while we are alive. The rich man came to his senses, but it was too late. He relied upon his wealth while he lived, only to find his riches were temporary, fleeting, and of no help to him after his death. Even the poverty and sickness of Lazarus was temporary. It is only spiritual things that are forever. Our culture, unfortunately, does not emphasize spiritual matters, certainly doesn't put much value on salvation. Live it up and have fun. You only live once, make it a good time. Nike even tells us to just do it. We're more concerned with having fun than with our future. We worry about popularity, prestige, but not about our place in heaven. We're more concerned with building up our 401ks and IRAs than with building up treasures for heaven. We are more worried about our own plans than with God's plans for our lives. And then, too, the rich man asked to have Lazarus go to his brothers so that they would repent and not follow the rich man into eternal torment. Once again, his request was denied. The brothers had ample opportunity during their lives to make right decisions. They had the writings of Moses and the teaching of the prophets. It was up to them to listen and follow God's will. Today, we have the Bible, don't we? The Word of God. It tells us of the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. It tells us that we are all sinners and that the wages of sin, everlasting torment, agony, separation from God. But it also gives us the good news, the gospel, that if we confess our sin and repent, if we accept Jesus, we have forgiveness. We can spend eternity with God in our heavenly home, just like Lazarus. This gospel message is simple, and yet so many hear the message, but they do not act on it. For some, they think they can worry about it later. Put it off. Procrastination is rejection. Procrastination is the rejection of Jesus Christ. Other folks have convinced themselves that their own goodness will provide them with salvation. They go to church, put money in the offering, maybe even sing in the choir or teach a Sunday school class. Surely this religious activity will get them to heaven, they think. The reality, of course, is that those things won't. Not unless we humble ourselves before Almighty God, confess our sin, and ask for forgiveness. The forgiveness that was purchased by the blood of Jesus Christ, we have salvation. So many are deceived because they believe in God. They believe, but they haven't accepted him as Lord and Savior. They have a head knowledge of God, but he isn't in their hearts. When they die, they'll miss heaven by about 18 inches. We can't just know about God and be saved. The Bible tells us even the demons in hell believe in God's existence. We can't live a good enough life. No amount of religious activity will get us to heaven. We can't earn our way into salvation. Ephesians 2:8-9 says that by grace you have been saved through faith and not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works. Our only hope for salvation is accepting the sin debt that Jesus paid on our behalf. But we must accept it during our earthly lives. After we die, it's too late, as the rich man found out. Some here tonight perhaps have heard the gospel message before, but haven't acted on it. You're not truly sure of your salvation. But tonight you can be sure. You don't have to leave here with any doubt. There may be others here who have accepted God's salvation, but you've strayed in your Christian walk. Perhaps you're not reading the Bible much. Maybe you only say a grace or a few perfunctory prayers, if any. But tonight you can have a spiritual renewal. You can recommit yourself to the Lord. Earlier tonight, I said you will face the most important decision of your life. What will you do with God? So you see, to not decide is a choice. To not decide is a choice. It's a rejection of him. Don't wait. Don't put it off. Behold, now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation, 2 Corinthians 6:2. Tomorrow is not promised to any of us. Tomorrow will never come. None of us know the end of our days on earth, when that will be. None of us know when Jesus Christ may return. But in either case, it will be too late then to choose. Jesus said, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come to them. He lives and he loves you. He loves you so much that he went to the cross and died for you and for your sins and mine. He came into the world to give us life, life that we could have it more abundantly. Amen?
Amen.
Sadly, millions of people will die in their sin, unwilling to believe the true gospel. But after their last breath, after the last beat of their heart, they will be fully convinced, fully aware of eternal things. What about you? Where will you spend eternity? The answer depends on the decisions you make during your time here on earth. You can choose to live trusting in the folly of your own goodness or your material things, only to end up like the rich man. Or you can open your heart to Jesus Christ and accept the salvation that he offers. You can be with Lazarus and with Jesus and God in heaven. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, help us to live each day of our lives here on earth with an eternal perspective. Give us the courage and will Lord, to lay up those treasures in heaven and also to share the good news, the gospel, with those around us. Lord, if any here tonight have never accepted your grace, I pray that they will do so tonight. And for any who have perhaps wandered and lost sight of you, Lord, touch their heart and renew their spirit, I pray. And all these things I ask in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Jeff. Do you have your song sheets with you yet? Roll this call with Jan and Tammy. Thank you for pumping the old organ. And, at home, we have a player piano that you have to pump. It's real old. We did the work gang brought down from Elmira on our 50th birthday. And once in a while, we get Tammy pumping on it. Put in a few little gold rolls. And if you slow down, the music slows down. But always remember that. Supposed to own up to things that we did wrong. judge of all humankind, Jesus Christ, will judge each and every individual who's ever walked the face of the earth. And I want you to know that there's two different types of judgment. There's one for the believer and one for the unbeliever. And we obviously know when the unbeliever is cast into the lake of fire for all of eternity. And this is a kind of a message you would hear in the day from anyone who stood here, especially way back in the day. It's an old time gospel message. You can't put any sugar coating on it. You can't sweeten it up. And there's the judgment of those who have received Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. But when you get there, if you don't have him as your Savior, and they open up the book, the Lamb's Book of Life, and is your name written there, when the roll is called up yonder, will you be there? Will your name be there? Only you know that, okay? And it's you and the Lord who will stand face to face. No one else will be there. You can't blame any other people. It's you and the Almighty God. And that's one of the things that drew me close to the Lord early on in my life, was the fact that I was going to meet him someday, personally, face to face, and you all will. And you can deny it, say, I'm not going, I won't be there, but yes, you will. Definitely be there, whether you want to be or not. And the judgment will come. Another thing I want to cap here tonight for you, it's easy to say, well, what kind of a life is that when we're thinking about death and the things that go on? An old preacher that talked to me years ago when I was just a kid, he says, you can never truly learn to enjoy life. And that's what God wants us to do while we're here. You can never truly learn to enjoy life unless you've figured out all about death.
Amen.
Okay? And once you've settled that, knowing that this body, this flesh, no matter how swift and how good it is at this point, even the young folks, I was Abby's age once, believe it or not, just a little while ago, we will fail, and as Jeff said. But if you call on the Lord and you know where you're going after that is settled in your life, in your mind, in your soul, you can go forward with a smile on your face and be able to take life in a way that you've never taken life before. There's so many depressive things that surround us that try to draw us down. I want you to know, if you know Christ as your Savior, you can build on that, and you can go forward, you can smile, you can shake somebody's hand, you can bring them a greeting and offer them this or that or the other thing, and somebody's going to say, and I've had them say it to me before, what's wrong with you? So, it's like, you smile once in a while when no one else can, and the Lord does that for you, okay? So there is hope, there is a reason to smile. Settle with God now, at this point, and then we're going to sing, have Wade sing for us here in a little bit. But I want you to light your candles, okay, as we draw to the close here. Have all your candles lit. We've done this before last year, and I can't remember the year before. I mean, COVID slammed in hard 2 years ago, but we managed to gather as best we could. Last year, it was still kind of on the prowl, and we did well. And this year, it seems like we're around in front of it much better than at any point in the last 2 years. But I want you to know there are many things that have transpired in the last 2 years, certainly in our country. Jeff has mentioned some of the issues that go on, but I want you to know that there is also many people in this world, in our United States especially, that we need to honor and think about and remember. And certainly would be anyone who is in the pastor field, the medical field, law enforcement, military, anybody that had to work while everybody, or a lot of people, were seemingly closed in. That light can also shine for someone who is special in your life, who has gone on to be with Jesus. I want you to think about that tonight. And I also want you to hold that light high for what these people came to this country, came to this area after the revolution, and uphold it as Wade sings, God Bless America. And after he sings God Bless America, we're going to pause again before the closing prayer. And I'm going to ask anyone that would like to raise their hand. And if they're feeling like they need renewal, if they feel a call to accept Christ as their Savior, maybe they've never come to that point or not. And I'm telling you, I've seen some pretty big, tough guys come to know Jesus Christ as their Savior. I think that's one of the things that drew me into that circle as a young person. It was the guy that was out there with the gun and hunting the deer and riding the barrel wheel and cutting the logs and wrestling cows and all kinds of things. It's not for the faint of heart, so to speak. But I'm going to ask you, Wade, if you'd come up. Everybody's candles lit. Would you please hold them up so that not only I can see them, but the world can see them and God can see them. And it means what it means to you in your heart. But certainly, we need to truly and genuinely, as Wade will beller it out for us, let these rafters ring. We do need to have God truly bless America again. And it starts here. It starts with you, the individual, here in these United States. And it can come back. Shall we listen to Wade sing that? And then I'll be up in a minute.
Please help me on the second time through. God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with the light from above. From the mountains to the prairie to the ocean, white with foam, God bless America, my home, sweet home. God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with the light from above. From the mountains to the prairie to the ocean, white with foam.
Consider what God has offered you tonight. Maybe you've been feeling like I accepted Christ as my Savior, but things have been like an old dead battery, kind of running a little low. I somehow feel like I need to reconnect with God. I urge you to consider. Now, in a traditional church setting, we would say come forward to the altar, but in this, it's designed quite different, and it's a little hard to get in and out. It's the boards on the end and all that. So what I'm going to ask you to do is remain in your pew, but I'm gonna really ask you to consider if God is speaking to your heart, and I don't care how old you are or how young you are. There's not a legal age that we can accept Christ as our Savior. When you get to that point where you know God is calling you, it's time. And if you feel God is calling you, I'm gonna ask you to pray the sinner's prayer with me and consider what he has to offer. And then we'll have the closing prayer after that. But I'll stop and talk with you in just a minute or two more. Shall we just bow our heads and become in an attitude of prayer? Keep your candle lit. It's just a battery, so keep it lit. Dear Heavenly Father, as we consider this place, 200 years of being your house, and a church is only a church if your people are in it. And if the walls could talk and sing, I'm sure they would be very happy that we are here tonight, once again praising your name. As they look at us, we thank you for what you have presented to us and to those early people, as was accounted with tonight with the young ladies that got up and we heard about how tough it was in the day, and yet they persevered. They knew there was something. There was a reason to gather here in this place. There was a cause. We know that you're here, for you have promised to be with us after you went to the to be with your Father, and you sit at the right hand of your Father. You promise to be with us with the Holy Spirit forever until you return. You call us here tonight as you use Brother Jeff to convey your message to the people, your gospel, your call. Just as so many of us have answered the call and we feel we need to come closer, and so many of us are considering whether or not I should even consider such a proposal. Why am I even here? I could be doing better things. But we know each and every one has to answer. And I'm talking to each and every one of you as you sit in the pews. You can't look at left, you can't look right, forward or back. It's you. God looks at you directly. He knows you personally. He knows the hairs on your head. He knows all about you. He calls you by name, and you're special to him. No matter what the world might say to any individual that there's just no hope for me, I'm no good, God never sees it that way. God didn't make any junk. We do thank you for the opportunity to bring ourselves to this point for all of eternity. As we look to the throne where you are seated at this time, and there's nothing that gets by you, an omnipotent God, the God of the universe, the King of kings and the Lord of lords, the Savior, our friend. I speak to each and every one who wants to lift up their heart to accept you as their personal Savior. And if you do, I'm going to have you pray along with me in your heart. Shall we pray? Pray like this. Dear Heavenly Father, I've considered all these things that I've heard here tonight. And I feel there is a need. I feel something touching my soul. There's a nagging. There's a tug. Just what if? What if it is true? What if I will stand before Holy God? It's just me and the Almighty. I can't turn around. There'll be no help. I'm going to face him. What a wonderful experience that would be if Jesus will say, thank you. Your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Thank you for serving me. Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy and the pleasure and the eternal home of the Lord which I've created for you. We do pray that you would feel this call, and if you feel the need and you've never accepted Christ as your Savior before, this is the way you do it. Very simple, very easy, very free. And after that, he says, take up the cross, my cross. Follow me and we'll go out into the world. Much the same as the people did that they gathered here. We pray this all in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Now, there's a few things I want to mention. On the way out, there's a basket, not the candle basket, but another one. And we always put an offering in, because that offering, every penny of it, will go to the preservation of the building. And it does take some, there's a committee that serves on it. We're not a part of it here, but they do strive to keep things painted and roofs. And so anything you drop in there will go directly to them. There's no other place that it can go or will go. And just remember tonight, it's well lit to go up, but I have the crew that was outside on the porch to help anyone who might need a little assistance as you come down off the steps. They're the way they were, you know, that's the kind of place that it is. And the light cord is all the way up that leads the way to the ice cream and the treats. And I urge you, it's a beautiful August night as we work our way through summer, to fellowship with your friends, your neighbors, have some ice cream before you go home. And there's plenty of cookies as well. Again, thank everybody who's taken part here, who's come down here. And I want you to mark your calendars, kind of open the middle of August up, because we'll do this again next year, and maybe you can tell a friend. It's not just a Methodist program here. When these people came here, this was the first church that was anywhere between Williamsport and Ithaca, New York, and points east and west. Everybody worshiped here, and they can again. So I invite people to come. It's just a great place to celebrate. Again, let's bow our heads for the closing prayer. And as we disperse, be careful. It's starting to get a little bit dark. And make your way out. Father, we praise you and thank you again for being able to gather in your house, this old house. This old house that was made with human hands striving to make their way in the wilderness. You provided a way. You saw fit, and it preserves. It is preserved for us here today to worship him. I thank you for each and every one who has made their way here. From whatever it was they had planned to do tonight, they decided to come here, and they will be blessed for it. We pray that for those who traveled a long way, that you will give them a great blessing and safety and guidance on their way home. And for those that travel the short way, give us guidance and strength as we move on from this place. And joy in our hearts that we can share with others and tell others about the experience we had here in hearing about you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And again, I thank you for coming out tonight.